Father, we come to you as we have this second service here for the Lord's Day here, that we could just honor and worship you, Lord. Father, we just pray that you might bless this service, might bless your servant, give me the words that need to be said. As we begin to look at Philemon here that's located in the New Testament here, as we start some studies on some of this. And Father, we just pray that you bless each and everyone that's here, all those that are listening. And as I said before this morning, all those Christians around the world that are trying to serve you, Father, we just ask the blessings on each and every one. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to be looking at doing a study here on Philemon. Philemon is the 18th book of the New Testament and the 57th book of the Holy Bible. Philemon is one of the shortest books in the New Testament, with only one chapter of 25 verses, and was written by Paul. This short book falls between Titus and Hebrews. So Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, and the book of James. Some say he wrote this letter about the same time he wrote Colossians. Philemon, along with Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians, are known as Paul's prison epistles or letters, and it is believed they were written during Paul's first imprisonment in Rome. You know, that's that when the book of Acts talks about him when he got sentenced there to Rome, and he had sat there for 2 years. He was there. And it's believed during this time is when he wrote these four epistles. Remember, epistle just means a letter. The book of Philemon is about his slave Onesimus, who was Philemon's slave or servant, who had run away and eventually ran into Paul, who led him to the Lord, and he got saved. It is believed that Philemon and Onesimus lived in Colossae, or maybe Laodicea. Onesimus was at least a Colossian. Look at Colossians chapter 4, verse 9. So just keep your finger here in Philemon and turn to Colossians chapter 4, verse 9. Right after Philippians here. We've got Philippians and Colossians. So Colossians chapter 4, verse 9. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Colossians chapter 4, verse 9. With Onesimus, a faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you, they shall make known unto you all things which are done here. Now he's writing to the Colossians, and he's saying he's one of him. So that's telling you that Onesimus is a Colossian. And there's other places that do indicate that more than likely, Philemon also lived here in Colossae. And, you know, that's probably where he got him in the first place, because he was a Colossian. And so, you know, that's how he was able to obtain him as a servant. Paul wrote this letter to Philemon, who it seems Paul also led to the Lord, in asking Philemon to forgive Onesimus and receive him back as a new brother in Christ rather than as a slave or servant. Philemon had the authority under Roman law to punish Onesimus, but Paul was asking Philemon not to punish him, as now he was worthy as a Christian brother. Paul reminded Philemon how much he owed Paul for leading him to the Lord, and he asked for the same treatment for his former slave servant. The number 25 means forgiveness of sins, and as I said earlier, Philemon only has 25 verses, and this book is all about forgiving sins of those who have wronged us. You know, here it is. Paul was asking Philemon to forgive the sin of what Onesimus had done to him. You know, that's what this whole book is all about. The number 18 means bondage, and the book of Philemon is about the bondage of Onesimus and the bondage of sin of the unsaved. Remember, this is the 18th book of the New Testament. So the number 18 means bondage, and that's what this whole book is about Onesimus being in bondage, originally not only to sin until he got saved, you know, when Paul led him to the Lord, but also he was in bondage to Philemon. So again, we see the significance of numbers in Scripture, how a lot of times they all, pieces fall together. They're not just randomly thrown in there like many people think, that we could just switch the order of books and so forth. Philemon teaches us that all who are Christians are equal in Jesus Christ, no matter if we are rich or poor, Jew or Gentile, servant or free, or what color of skin we have, or whether we're male or female. Jesus places us all on a level playing field. Onesimus had run away from his master in Philemon for whatever reason. Scripture doesn't say exactly why he ran away, but I mean, do you really need a reason to run away in one sense? If you're, you know, being a servant or whatever, then, you know, obviously it's not something that anybody really wants to do. God guided him to Rome, where he met Paul and got saved. God will often supernaturally guide people to Christians that he knows will give them the gospel they need to hear. And Paul was one of those Christians, and he knew that Paul would tell him the gospel. You know, he's not going to lead him to some Christian that doesn't ever preach the gospel, doesn't ever tell anybody about salvation or anything like that, doesn't even tell anybody they're a Christian. God's not going to lead somebody that's searching for the truth to somebody like that. He wants to lead him to somebody that's a soul winner. And he knew that Paul was one of these great soul winners. As Christians, we need to be ready for someone coming to us. You know, that's why we need to know Scripture, so that God will send people to us. You know, we should ask God to send people like Onesimus to us so we can lead him to the Lord. And Paul reminds Philemon that his servant was now saved, and so they were equal in Jesus Christ. But as I said, it wasn't an accident. It was supernaturally that when Onesimus ran away, he didn't just accidentally run into Paul. You know, it was a supernatural thing that God purposely led him to Paul, so this way he could hear the gospel and get saved. You know, and people always say, talk about these coincidences and this and that. You know, there's no coincidences in life. God always has these, you know, it's a purpose why you run into somebody in a particular location. You know, whether you're in a store or at church or wherever it may be, there's a reason why God has you run into these people, and it's not just some coincidence. All right, let's go ahead and start looking at the verses. So let's go to Philemon in verse 1. Remember, there's only one chapter here. So Philemon verse 1. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy our brother, unto Philemon our dearly beloved and fellow laborer. The first verse shows us that Paul was a prisoner at the time he wrote this book. I mentioned a while ago, but Paul was a prisoner in Rome at the time, yet he does not say he was a prisoner of the Roman emperor, but rather of Jesus Christ, as it was because of his preaching of Jesus Christ that Paul was in prison. Now, Paul was not necessarily complaining about that or whatever. He was just stating that, you know, the reason why he was in prison is because he was preaching the Lord Jesus Christ and salvation. You know, it wasn't just that he did anything wrong and then the Roman emperor threw him in there. He was only in there because he was preaching the word of God. You know, we see that around nations all the time, like China and other places where that happens, India and so forth. It appears that Timothy was in prison with Paul, though it is possible that he was just there for encouragement and comfort, though we do know that Timothy was in prison at least once, and Paul often mentions him with him in his prison epistles. So, you know, it seems to be mentioned a lot, and I know they used to work together on the mission field before he got put in prison, so, you know, it's possible Timothy was there to help encourage him and so forth. But Scripture does say that, we're going to see that here in a minute, but we know that Timothy was in prison at one point, and whether it was at the same time and he was in prison there, you know, at the same time as Paul, you know, and that's why he's mentioned so much in the prison epistles or whatever, we're not really sure, but at some point Timothy was in prison. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 13 verse 23 and we'll see that. So Hebrews chapter 13 verse 23, if you would turn there please. Remember, it's just the next book over. So Hebrews chapter 13, verse 23. Know ye that our brother Timothy is set at liberty, with whom, if he comes shortly, I will see you. So, you know, in order to be set at liberty, obviously you had to have your freedom taken away. He had to have been in prison at some point. And, you know, so then he'd been released. Philemon is shown as a fellow Christian when referred to as a fellow laborer, and Paul clearly loves him. You know, we see that in here in back in Philemon, verse 1, at the very end, it refers to Philemon and says, our dearly beloved and fellow laborer. So, you know, we know that he really was a true Christian, and he was trying to do things for the Lord. He wasn't just one of those sit back and do nothing Christians, you know, milk Christian or whatever. He was a meat Christian trying to win people for the Lord. So he wasn't, you know, he was out there doing the work of the Lord, just like Paul, trying to win souls for the Lord. And he was a fellow laborer in the work. All right, Philemon 2. And to our beloved Apphia and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in thy house. Paul also mentions a couple other believers, with Archippus being a fellow soldier, so he must have been strong in spreading God's word. You know, he's not talking about, I don't believe, as a literal military soldier. He's talking about a soldier for the Lord. I've preached on that before, but as Christians, that's what we need to do. We're in a battle against Satan, and we need to be a soldier for the Lord and go out there and witness. And I think that's what he's talking about here with Archippus. He was another one of those strong believers that was out there trying to win souls for the Lord. Philemon apparently had a church in his house. You know, it says at the very end, to the church in the house. So apparently Philemon was leading a church in his house. You know, he was probably the leader of the church. Most churches were house churches at this time due to persecution of believers. You know, all your true churches in China are still that way today. They're a, quote, public government churches, but they're all communist run. But your true believing churches are all underground. They're those house churches, just like they had here in those days, at the early part during the persecution. Now, scripture doesn't say this, but according to history, then Apphia was Philemon's wife and Archippus his son. Now, this may or may not be true. You know, again, I'm not going to be adamant that that's true because it doesn't say that in scripture. But according to historical tradition or whatever, then Apphia was actually Philemon's wife and Archippus his son. And it does seem to make some sense that they're mentioned with him and then talk about the church in his house, or either they were just some strong believers that were part of this house church, either way, you know. So either it's his family or they were just some strong believers that were also part of this church, this house church. Philemon 3. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul wishes grace to all of them and peace, but shows these things only come from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, true peace can only come from God and Jesus, Lord Jesus Christ. You're never going to have peace without having Jesus in your life. And even then, you have to be walking right with Jesus in order to really enjoy that peace. Philemon 4, I thank my God, making mention of thee always in my prayers. Paul says he thanks God and that he mentions Philemon always in his prayers. Paul was always remembering those he taught and ministered to, even after he had long moved on to a new location. We should too. Paul also realizes that it is only by God that he can do this, and he also thanks God for letting him having met Philemon. You know, if you read in Paul's epistles, he went on and he founded a lot of different churches and so forth on his missionary journeys. But he never forgot the people. When he moved on to a new location to found another church, he would continue to pray for those previous people. And we see that in this verse here as well. That he hasn't forgotten Philemon. You know, he led this man to the Lord, and he has not forgotten, especially since this man, you especially remember the ones that, in this case, like Philemon, when he starts a house church and is being strong in the Lord, you're going to remember those people more so than somebody that gets saved, but they just kind of saved us by fire type Christian. Philemon 5. Hearing of thy love and faith, which thou hast toward the Lord Jesus and toward all saints. Paul said he has heard of Philemon's great love to the Lord Jesus as well as to the saints. Again, remember, saints are all true Christians. Philemon also had great faith. These two things are necessary to make a strong Christian who is a soul winner. In order to be a soul winner, you must have that faith in the Lord that what you're doing is not a waste of time. You know, it says his word will not return void. So whether you're handing out tracts or you're just talking to people, witnessing on the streets or the park or whatever, or wherever you may be doing there in church or something, that you have to have that great faith. And you also have to have that love for the Lord as well as for the people that you're trying to win for the Lord. Those are the two things that are necessary to make you a strong Christian, as I said, and be a great soul winner. Philemon seems to have Jesus first in his life, just as he and all of us should. So Philemon, you know, it seems to be a really good Christian here. So Paul is writing to him, hoping that, you know, as a good Christian, he will listen to what he has to say in the rest of this epistle. He has faith that he's going to listen to him because he is a strong Christian. Philemon 6, that the communication of thy faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. Paul tells Philemon that his faith will remain strong if he understands that all he has is due to Jesus Christ. True faith will be seen in our communication. So again, he's telling him, you know, to remain strong, that if he keeps that faith in the Lord, you know, and that love for the Lord and stuff we were just talking about, then, you know, and obviously he had the strong faith we saw in verse 5 because Paul was hearing about it. You know, he wasn't there, but he was still here. Like I said, you hear about great Christians around the world because of their love and their faith. Those are the ones that you hear about. You know, like I said, somebody that's just a whatever. Most people don't, even fellow Christians, don't know who a lot of them are because, you know, he had great faith because Paul was hearing about this all the way off into prison there in Rome. So he wasn't even in the same country. But verse Philemon 7, for we have great joy and consolation in thy love because the bowels of the saints are refreshed by thee, brother. So Paul said that fellow believers have been refreshed by Philemon and the great joy he brings them. And again, he refers to him as a brother because he is a true born-again believer. When a Christian is on fire for the Lord, this will bring great joy to believers, especially if it is someone you led to the Lord, as Paul had with Philemon. You know, that's what I said a while ago. When you know, if you lead someone to the Lord and then they go off and become some great missionary or a preacher or something like that, and they're a big soul winner, obviously you're going to... It's just natural, our flesh nature and so forth, that you're going to rejoice greatly over something like that versus somebody else that you might have led to the Lord, that you still rejoice over that, but they haven't really done anything. They got saved, as I said, by fire, and then they just wither away and don't ever do anything for the Lord. You know, so they're still going to heaven because they're saved, but you know, you're not going to have that same joy as if you see as someone that's strong in the Lord and loves the Lord the way Philemon did. Philemon 8. Wherefore, though I might be much bold in Christ to enjoin thee that which is convenient. Paul is saying he needs to talk to Philemon about a matter. In this case, it's dealing with Onesimus. And he could be bold about the matter as an apostle, but he will not use that authority, but rather seek out Philemon as a friend and brother in Christ. So he's saying that, you know, he has this matter that basically when it's convenient for you, that, you know, we're going to discuss it here. We need to discuss it. But you know, he could have used his authority as an apostle, but he, you know, Paul didn't ever do that for the most part. Philemon 9. Yet for love's sake, I rather beseech thee, being such an one as Paul the aged, and now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Paul said that he would talk to Philemon not as an apostle, but in love's sake, almost as a dad to Philemon. As Paul was now getting old. You know, he was probably much older than Philemon. It says, you know, he was aged. And some people have said he was in his 60s. We don't really know. Scripture doesn't say. But obviously he was getting older. It says he's aged. So he wasn't some young individual anymore. Paul again says he is a prisoner of Jesus Christ and not of Nero, who was probably the Roman emperor. You know, Nero was the one that was really the one that first started the persecution of the Christians heavily in force. And it's believed that Nero was the emperor at this time when Paul was in prison. But whoever it was, once again, he doesn't say he was a prisoner of Rome, the Roman emperor, but yet a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Because again, like I said, that's why he was ultimately in prison, was for preaching about Jesus Christ. You know, the Jews didn't like that. And so they accused him of blasphemy and so forth, and he got sent off to prison. Paul is proud to be in prison for serving Jesus and not the least bit ashamed. So, you know, we should not be either. You know, if you're there for preaching the word, you know, if you're there for doing something wrong, that's a different story. But if you're there for preaching the word, you know, we should not be ashamed of this, because, you know, there are many great Christians that have gone off and had to serve prison time because of preaching the word of God. And Paul was not ashamed to tell you twice that he was a prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that doesn't mean that you know, people say, you know, that we're prisoner in the sense that we're held hostage and we can't, you know, God controls everything, we have no control over our lives. That's not true. That's not what it's talking about here. It's just saying that, you know, he was serving the Lord, and it's because he was serving the Lord that's why he was in this physical prison here. Philemon 10. I beseech thee for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten in my bonds. Paul now says he is writing to Philemon on behalf of his son Onesimus. Onesimus was not a literal son of Paul, but a child, in that Paul had led him to the Lord while in bonds. In other words, while he was still in prison. As an older Christian, this would make Paul his dad, as we are to treat older Christians as dads and younger as brothers. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 1. So go back three books. You know, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and then Titus, and 5. So 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 1. But you know, he was referring to him as the son, and the fact that he was an older Christian versus this was this younger, brand new Christian and so forth. So now it was a physical difference in age, but also in maturity as a Christian. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 1. Rebuke not an elder, but entreat him as a father, and the younger men as brethren. You know, brethren means brother. Look at Philemon 11. Which in time past was to thee unprofitable, but now profitable to thee and to me. Paul says he knows Onesimus had been unprofitable to Philemon, but he says he is now profitable to him as a fellow believer. You know, Philemon was also profitable to Paul because he had helped him out in, you know, his time while he was in prison, you know, comforted him and so forth. It is only Jesus who makes a person profitable. Onesimus had been an unbeliever and just a servant or slave to Philemon. But now, as a fellow believer, he had become profitable as he worked for the Lord. You know, he was going out there, as I said, he was going out there now helping Paul. And, you know, Paul really didn't want to even send him back because he was being useful to him in the ministry, especially with him being locked up in prison. He could have Philemon go out and do some of the things that Paul was not able to do because he was locked away in prison. So he'd become profitable not only to Paul. Paul was saying he would now be profitable for you, because even if he became your servant still again, he would be a much more profitable servant, because he would now serve you, because he'd be serving the Lord rather than being rebellious and disobedient. But he's also now a brother in Christ as well. Philemon 12, whom I have sent again, thou therefore receive him, that is mine own bowels. Paul says he has sent back Onesimus to Philemon, as this was the right thing to do, even though he was more profitable to Paul there in Rome with him. Paul says for Philemon to receive him back as if he was Paul's own son. So he was saying that, again, it's not his own literal son, but he was saying, receive him as if he was my literal son. You say you care about me, now receive my son just like you would if I were coming. And, you know, take him back as a brother in Christ. And Paul, as I said, he did not really want to have to send him back, because he was saying that Philemon was more profitable for him being there, but it was the right thing to do. That as much as he would have preferred to have Onesimus there to help him out. The right thing was to return him back to his servant, so his master, in this case, Philemon. Philemon 13, whom I would have retained with me, that in thy stead he might have ministered unto me in the bonds of the gospel. Paul says he would have preferred to have kept Onesimus with him, since he has ministered unto him while Paul was in bonds. So again, he tells, you know, what I just said, he would have rather have retained him because he was ministering unto him while he was in prison. But, you know, Paul still did the right thing in returning him. Philemon 14, but without thy mind would I do nothing, that thy benefit should not be as it were of necessity, but willingly. Paul says he wants Philemon to receive Onesimus back as a believer, but he as an apostle will not force Philemon to do so, but wants Philemon's own conscience to do the right thing. In other words, basically Paul was asking him, don't take him back as a servant once again, but yet this rather as a fellow believer in Christ, that he can help you in your house church and do other things for you, rather than making him back as a servant. But he said, I as an apostle have that authority, I could do that, but I'm not going to do that. I want your own conscience, the Lord to work on you, the Holy Ghost to convict you, to do the right thing. And he trusts them that he will do the right thing. So Philemon 15, for perhaps he therefore departed for a season, that thou shouldest receive him forever. Paul says that perhaps God had Onesimus to run away, knowing that he had ordained a meeting with Paul, so that Onesimus would get saved, which he would not have if he had not run away. Paul says by Onesimus running away, Philemon could receive him back forever as a brother in Christ, rather than as a servant. So, you know, Paul was telling him, look, you know, this was a God-ordained thing. You know, you might think that this was, you know, why, you know, I should punish him, that he was my servant, he ran away. But God had him run away for a purpose, so that he could, knowing that he would run into Paul and get saved. And then, as I said, now he would be much more useful to you as a fellow believer in Christ, be able to help you in that underground house church than he would as have been if he had just still been your servant. Look at Philemon 16. Not now as a servant, but above a servant, a brother beloved, especially to me, but how much more unto thee, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So Paul says to Philemon to no longer see Onesimus as a servant, but rather a brother in Jesus Christ. In the flesh, Onesimus was a servant to Philemon, but in the Lord, Philemon is a brother. So it's like I said, that now he was much more, you know, he was a servant to him, but now he's much more than that. He's much above that. He's your brother in Christ, and so he's much more useful to you as a fellow believer than as a servant. So Paul wants Philemon to understand that. Philemon 17, if thou count me therefore a partner, receive him as myself. Paul says if you see him as a partner in the service to the Lord, then receive Onesimus just as he would if Paul came. Paul was showing that all in Jesus Christ are equal, including a former servant being equal with an apostle. You know, he was saying that now, you know, Paul might be an apostle, but Onesimus, as a fellow believer, was still equal with him. That, you know, we're not above, just because one's an apostle, one's something else, doesn't make him above, that, you know, we're all equal. And Philemon, even though he might have been his master, he was also still equal, you know, because as a master, he had a master above him in the Lord Jesus Christ. So he's trying to show him that, you know, look, if you think of me, Paul's saying, Philemon, if you think of me as a partner in the work for the Lord, you need to receive Onesimus just as if you would receive me. As if I were to come and help you out in this church, you need to take back Onesimus in that way too, so that you can help, he can help you out in the work of the Lord, rather than you making him back a servant again. Philemon 18, if he hath wronged thee or oweth thee aught, put that on mine account. Paul says to put on his account for any wrong that Onesimus had done to Philemon. Paul says you should forgive Onesimus' debt to you, but if you cannot, then Paul will pay for it just as Jesus paid for our sin debts. So in other words, you know, whatever money you might have lost because he ran away, if you can't forgive him for that or whatever, Paul says, when I get out of prison, I will reimburse you for that money, that even though we're going to see in this next verse that you owe me, but I will, you know, make sure that you get repaid, you know, if you're not willing to forgive Onesimus for his debt. Look at Philemon 19. I, Paul, have written it with mine own hand. I will repay it, albeit I do not say to thee how thou owest unto me, even thine own self besides. Paul says he has written with his own hand that he will repay any debt owed by Onesimus as in a signed written contract. So he's saying, it's right here in writing, that I will repay you any debt that you will not forgive Onesimus. But Paul reminds Philemon that he owes Paul for Paul having led him to the Lord, so that now Philemon has everlasting salvation, which he probably would not have had were it not for Paul's preaching to him of the gospel. So, you know, he's saying, look, I will pay for any debts that you refuse to forgive, but technically you owe me a debt that if I hadn't led you to the Lord, you'd be on your way to hell right now. That you can never repay somebody for having led you to the Lord, telling you about Jesus. And obviously, nobody can repay the Lord for what he did for us at Calvary. So, you know, Paul's trying to say that, look, debts go both ways here. That, you know, and I never came after you for anything. So Philemon 20. Yea, brother, let me have joy of thee in the Lord. Refresh my bowels in the Lord. Paul says that for Philemon to honor his request would bring him great joy in the Lord, not just for Paul, but also for Philemon, as he believes this request is also from God. Doing the right thing would also bring joy to Philemon. You know, so he's telling him, look, if you just do what I believe God is saying that you need to do, you know, this is just not my request, but I believe it's coming from the Lord, then you will find that you will have much greater joy than if you go back and making Onesimus one of your servants. Philemon 21. Having confidence in thy obedience, I wrote unto thee, knowing that thou wilt also do more than I said. Paul says he has confidence that Philemon will listen to Paul's request and will receive Onesimus as a brother. He also believes that Philemon will also do the right thing in freeing Onesimus so that he may serve the Lord. So he believes that, you know, Paul has this confidence that he believes that Philemon will obey his request in releasing Onesimus as a servant and allowing him to help him serve in the Lord, you know, in that house church. You know, he has enough faith that he believes in that Philemon is a strong enough Christian that he will do the right thing. Philemon 22, but with all prepare me also a lodging, for I trust that through your prayers I shall be given unto you. So Paul also asked for Philemon's prayers for his own release. Besides that of Onesimus, he's also praying, you know, you pray that I get released. And for Philemon to prepare a lodging for him when he comes to visit, as he trusts that through Philemon's prayers, he will be released. By making this request, Paul seems to trust that his release will be soon. You know, Paul has enough faith that he believes that if these people pray for him, that he will be able to be allowed to be released. And he says, if I get released, I will come and visit you. And, you know, then we can just talk some more. But, you know, he's like, I need your prayers so that I can be released. You know, and that goes for all of us. As I said before, I prayed in the opening service prayer that we need to pray for Christians that are in bonds and stuff like that. Those that are in prison for serving the Lord and so forth. You know, we need to pray for them so that not only they get released, but also that their captives get led to the Lord. You know, and that's a command from the Lord anyway in Hebrews that we are to pray for those that are in bonds. Philemon 23. There salute thee Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus. Paul also asked for prayer for a fellow Colossian who is also in prison as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. Turn to Colossians chapter 4, verse 12. So Colossians chapter 4 and verse 12. Colossians chapter 4, verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that ye may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Colossians chapter 4, verse 12. Let me read that again. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that ye may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. So again, we see Epaphras is just like Onesimus is referred to as one of you. Well, this letter is being written to the Colossians, so it's telling you that he is a Colossian, just as Onesimus was. But he's also a servant of Christ, as Epaphras was, and that's why he was also in prison. So he was saying he was a fellow prisoner, just like Paul, for his preaching of the Lord. And he was asking that you pray for him as well, so that he may be released. But these men are all prisoners for preaching Jesus and not from doing any sinful thing that landed them in prison. Look at Philemon 24. So Philemon 24, Paul continues by mentioning some other names. So Philemon 24, Marcus, Aristarchus, Demas, Lucas, my fellow laborers. Paul names some other fellow laborers in the Lord that need to be prayed for as well. You know, we need to make sure that we're always praying for those that are out there doing the work. Not just for the ones that are in bonds, but even those ones that are free in this case. He's telling them, these are the ones that are trying to help Paul, and they're his fellow laborers and going out there trying to witness and win souls for the Lord. But notice that Mark and Luke are one of them to be prayed for. Remember, at one time, Paul did not trust Mark as he left him on the missionary field, but now he was profitable to Paul. So that's when they had that split with Barnabas and so forth, you know, and he took Silas, and then Mark went with Barnabas. But look at 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11. But he's saying, you know, that was back then, but now Mark is now profitable. He has changed, he has learned from his mistakes and sin and so forth, and he is walking rightly with the Lord and doing, you know, he is doing what is necessary to try to win souls. You know, he's become profitable. You know, so God can take a person like that that at one time is not necessarily doing what it should be, but now he is. So go to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11. It's just two books back from where we're at. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11. Only Luke is with me. Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. And then we know Lucas is Luke, the one that wrote the book of Luke, the Gospel of Luke. And he is, he was a physician and so forth. Remember, there was one time where Paul said that only Luke was with him there when he was in prison. You know, he was trying to get other people to come, but because of different reasons, they couldn't be there. And he said, only Luke is with me. You know, so Luke was one of them strong Christians as well, that he was a good friend of Paul's, and he, was always trying to minister to Paul. You know, and as a physician, he could also help out maybe as in medical issues as well. Let's look at this final verse. So go to Philemon 25. Philemon 25. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. Before we move on with that, I want to just go back to these couple verses that we mentioned. That, you know, a lot of times, if you notice in Paul's epistles, at the end, he'd always ask you to pray for certain people that were helping him out in the ministry and so forth. You know, Paul was always not just about himself, but he would ask for the prayers for those that were out there trying to win souls and stuff. And he would, he didn't forget the people that were trying to minister to him and to do things for the Lord. But Philemon 25, the grace for our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. Paul says, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with Philemon's spirit as he reads this letter and makes his decision about Onesimus. We see again how grace comes from God. You know, Paul understands that, you know, this grace is coming from the Lord Jesus Christ. And, it's only by this grace that Philemon could make this decision. But he was hoping that the Holy Ghost would convict his spirit to make this the right decision in dealing with Onesimus that Paul had requested. Scripture never says what Philemon ever did with Onesimus, but history seems to suggest that Philemon obeyed Paul's request and released Onesimus from servanthood. You know, again, we don't know for sure, but according to history and different things, and he apparently did. And just knowing what Paul was trusting enough that he was just a strong enough believer, I would say Philemon probably did release him from, you know, being a servant. And, you know, like you said, he realized having run this house church, he was more profitable, that he was helping out Paul there in prison, that he'd be much more profitable running, helping with the church and winning souls than he would have been as a servant. So this short book teaches us all about forgiveness and how once a person is saved, they become equal with us. This applies to even a person who was a longtime enemy who then gets saved. You know, many people have been persecuted. As I said, they've been in prison, been beaten by people and so forth. And then they end up leading the ones that put them in captivity to the Lord. And those people become strong Christians. You know, that once they get saved, their lives, if they were truly saved, their lives should change and they should try to want to serve the Lord. And, you know, so then they become profitable. You know, we've seen that in cases during World War II where Nazis and so forth would get saved and they turn around and would, instead of killing the Jews like they were doing, they were now helping the Jews to escape the Holocaust. So, you know, we see that's how the Lord works. He gets a hold of people and things change. He can turn one's lives around. And that's what this whole book is all about. You know, Onesimus started out as a basically just a servant that was not being of much use because he probably wasn't working very hard or anything else, and then runs away. But now he becomes this great servant for the Lord. Onesimus' salvation was sincere, as apparently he made a true change in his life to now serve the Lord and his people. His was not a fake conversion in an attempt to gain freedom. You know, many people have tried to do that. You know, I have people all the time, they come to church, supposed to get saved, this and that. But then their lives never change, whatever. Like I said, a lot of these people, they're fake conversions, that they never were truly saved. But Onesimus was not that. He was not just trying to say, oh, I got saved so I can get freedom. He truly, you can see in his life, things have changed. And Paul recognized that. May we all, as in closing, as Christians, grant Paul's request, that is really the Lord's request, to receive all true believers as our brothers and sisters in Christ, regardless of their past, but especially those who truly love the Lord and serve Him as Onesimus was doing. You know, as I said, obviously we are to love, you know, all those that are our brothers and sisters, but especially those that are out there trying to do the work of the Lord. Those that are out there trying to win souls, trying to do things that helping out those that are being soul winners or whatever, you know, financially or whatever it may be. You know, those that are trying to do the work of the Lord, those especially we need to be praying for, because those are the ones that are out there on the front lines, and especially in these nations where they're being persecuted and so forth, that they're putting their very lives on the line. But this short book can teach us, you know, a lot about forgiveness. So let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this book that you gave us, the short little book known as Philemon in the Scripture. And we know, Lord, that that's what this book is all about. It's about the forgiveness, showing how a person whose life might start out as something that's basically worthless, but yet he can turn around and get saved and become a great, great servant of the Lord. That he was no longer, Onesimus here, he was no longer a servant of Philemon, but he was rather now a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that should be what we should all strive for. You know, not just be a believer and just show up for church and just go through the motions, but rather, Lord, that we learn to want to serve you willingly be a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, and to be willing to die for the Lord Jesus Christ, to go out there, to witness, to win, try to win souls and try to stand firm in the faith, that we don't wither away and falter like many have done, that we stay strong until the day that you take us home, Lord. And Father, we just continue to pray for the church as a whole, but as I said, especially for those Christians that are out there witnessing for you, and also for those Christians that are in bonds for preaching your word, Lord. And Father, we just, again, thank you for what the Lord Jesus did for us on Calvary, that we can never repay you for what you did for us, that we are always in debt to you, Lord. And Father, we just ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.